clock runs faster than actual real time. It was like 80% of a second instead of a second. Good morning. Welcome to Valley Mills Christian Church. How are you guys doing this morning? I've got a few quick announcements for you. First, whether you are here in person or you have joined us viewing online, welcome. Please take a quick moment to fill out your online Connect card. You can do that by clicking the link below the videos, scanning the QR code behind me, or going to valleymillscc.org. Also on that Connect card is a way for you to mark prayer requests if you have any of those. There's also a prayer request form on our website if you want to use that for more detail. Next up, our Light the Night program has changed this year a little bit due to the COVID restrictions and things. So we're going to do a Light the Night at Home kit. This is something where you would invite your neighbors, grandkids, and your kids' friends in to have a little kind of a Halloween at home kind of thing. If you're wanting to do that with your neighborhood kids, please sign up by today to let us know how many kids you want to do. We're still looking for donations on candy and things like that. And you can pick up these packs to bring it home Friday, October 23rd. If you have any questions, you can see Tanya Henthorn. She is here this morning. I think she's back in the kids zone. You can check with her. Last but not least is our student ministry fall retreat. Is that Josh Bolton? Man, he's upright. Everybody give him a hand.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah, he had some, was it surgery? Yes? Back surgery, but he's back. He's back from back surgery. There's a joke in there somewhere. I don't know. Student Ministry Fall Retreat, teens grades 7 through 12 are invited to the Student Ministry Fall Retreat being held at Camp Allendale on this Friday, Friday through Sunday, October 30th through the 1st. So if you know of any kids, grades 7 through 12, it's going to be a fun week of worship, paintball, zip lining, and more. You can see Craig Rice if you have any details. He is out this morning. You can check with me if you have any questions about that, and I can point you in the right direction. Go ahead and stand and join me. I'm going to pray to open up the service. We're going to enter into a time of worship. And I know every Sunday we do kind of the same routine here, right? We sing the songs. We hear a message. Tom has got an amazing message for you this morning. I'm glad that you're here to hear it. But I don't want it to be a routine for you guys this morning. I want you to come in knowing that the reason that we do this, the reason we sing these songs and worship is because God has done such amazing things for us. Amen? Hopefully you recognize that, you see that, and it fills you with the fire and the passion to praise his name this morning. I'm going to go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much, God. We thank you for the love that you have for us, God, that even though we don't deserve it, you sent your son Jesus to die for us. God, you paid the price. That's just beyond words can describe. God, you love us in such a way that we can never fathom or understand. So we sing these songs to you, God, not that we have great voices or great playing ability or whatever. God, we empty our hearts to you because we are just called to do that in response to the love that you have shown us. So help us to sing our hearts out, open our minds to what you would have us learn this morning. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Come sing
in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope. Come invade us now. We are
Songs about darkness this morning. And I know those are dark times. I don't have to say that. I think it's on the forefront of all of our minds, right? But the good news is, it's not forever. We know who wins.
My hope is built on nothing less. Trust in Jesus' name.
Good morning. Thank you, worship team. Bob called me a couple weeks ago and said he was going to be out of town today and asked me if I would be available to bring the message today. So that is why I'm here. So welcome, and everybody watching online, welcome. He asked me to continue the sermon series we've been on about On Purpose and our mission, vision, and core values of the church. The mission we started with was, bring hope to your valley, which our vision. The mission would be then to love God, had a message on loving people, serving both, and then last week Bob got into our core values, and that is biblically surrendered, and today I'm going to be talking about authentically connected. He sent me some notes, which I really appreciate, to help me, and then I've added a few little things in it that I've put in my heart that I felt like add. So I don't know how it'll go, but we'll get through it. Let's go ahead and pray, and we'll get started. Father in heaven, thank you so much for this day, Lord, and thank you for all your wonderful blessings, and thank you for everyone that is here today, Lord, and listening online. And Lord, I pray you just use my voice as a tool, Lord, to preach your word, and that it would go out, and that lives would be changed, and hearts changed. And Lord, just pray that we would receive what you would have us to hear, and that would help us live our lives according to your will. In Jesus' name, amen. I believe that God created us to be relational beings. I find it interesting in the creation story that every time God created something, he said it was good. We hear in day one, he created it was good. Day two, it was good. He gets to the end, he's all finished. It says he rested, and then he didn't say it was good. He said it was very good. But we find out real quick in chapter 2, verse 18, that he saw something that wasn't good. And so if you would for me, please, I hope you have your Bibles with you. Turn to chapter 2, verse 18 for us. If you have it, say amen. It says, "The Lord God said, 'It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helper suitable for him.'" Now, I don't know why they didn't include the conversation that God and Adam had in this deal, but I heard it went something like this. God came down and told Adam that it wasn't good for him to be alone, and he was going to create a helper for him that was going to meet every emotional need he ever had, every physical need he ever had, would always be by his side, never argue with him, do anything he asked of her, and Adam said, "What's that going to cost me?" And God said, "An arm and a leg." And Adam thought about it for a minute and came back and said, "What can I get for a rib?" Just joking, ladies, but I think the real story is God looked down and saw Adam and thought to himself, "I can do better than that." And then he created Eve. So all the women said, amen to that, right? One thing I think this coronavirus has proved to us is I think that personal connection is crucial to our physical and our mental health. In a survey I read online this week, preparing for this, it said in the last 3 months that 25% of the respondents had experienced symptoms of anxiety. 24% said they have symptoms of depression, and 10% of those people said they had considered suicide at one point in the last 30 days. Twice as many people have committed suicide in 2020 compared to 2018. Now, I find this statistic interesting since there are 3.5 billion people connected to the internet. In 2016, Instagram reported over 600 million active users. I can't imagine what that number is now. And they have over 400 million daily active users. There are 2 billion monthly active Facebook users. Our world is connected more now than we have ever been. We have access to get to know people, see into their world, and get connected with people from the past. Yet according to a survey done by the Harris Poll, 72% of Americans have experienced loneliness. We have the power of connection at our fingertips, yet we don't know how to connect. We have become accustomed to the ease of internet connection, where we don't have to be totally honest, where we can upload the highlight reel of our life without actually stepping into the mess of anyone else's. I hope you realize what you see on social media is like a trailer in a movie. Have you ever seen the trailer of a movie and thought to yourself, man, this is going to be an awesome movie? And you watch that dude and that thing is absolutely nothing like you thought it would be. Well, the trailer's always awesome because all they show you is the exciting and good parts. Well, all you see on social media is people's good things and what they're doing and having fun and all that other stuff. So kind of a different deal when you look at that. Let's look for just a second at our current reality. First of all, let's talk about disunity. I believe Satan's number one way to destroy people's life is with division. He will attack the family by creating strife with husbands and wives, knowing if he can create division and destroy the biblical family that God originally designed, that he can tear the family apart. Boy, he does a great job at that. Not just family disunity, what about political disunity? I've never seen the division in this country like it is divided now. Now, I know political parties have always had their differences, but at the end of the day, it always seemed like they came together for the love of the country. But now the hatred on both sides is something like I have never seen in my entire lifetime. I'm actually shocked how many people who run for office in different things seem not to even like America and what it stands for. Now, I know our country is far from perfect, and there are a lot of things we need to fix, but I still think it's the greatest country in the world. It is such a great country that people who despise it won't leave it. Now, there's a difference between changing the country and trying to destroy the country. Peaceful protesting and disagreeing has always been a way for change. But if your idea of changing something is violence and destroying it, then to me, that's no way in the world to make a change. James Dobson said this, the founder of Focus on the Family. Dr. James Dobson shared this letter this week when it came to the election. He said, "This is not a junior high or high school popularity contest. I'm not voting for the person, I'm voting for the platform." Now, he did not say who to vote for, how you were voting, one way was right or the other. Then he listed a bunch of things that each party stood for. And after listing all those, he said this, "With all respect, this election isn't about you, and it certainly isn't about me. It's about our kids and our grandchildren." Another reality we face today is intolerance. I find it amazing that the only thing you are not to be tolerant against is intolerance. It seems like you can't disagree with anyone anymore without being considered hateful. We live in a cancellation culture. There are people literally losing jobs for voicing a disagreement on something. Just a different opinion can get somebody fired from his job is hard to believe. Why can't people just disagree to disagree and still be friendly? Let's look at our example for just a second, Jesus, and see how important he thought unity was. Turn, if you would, for me, please, to the Gospel of John, chapter 17. It might shock you to know that Jesus' last prayer before he was arrested in the garden to go to his death on the cross was about you and me. John chapter 17, verse 20 through 26. If you have it, say amen. I would say the last prayer you make just before you're getting ready, knowing you're getting ready to go to your death, is probably a pretty important prayer, I would think. He said, "My prayer is not for them alone," talking about his disciples, but he said, "I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, may they be brought to complete unity to let the world know that you sent me and you have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them, and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them, and that I myself may be in them. Let me ask you a question. Has Jesus' prayer been answered? Now, unity doesn't mean you agree with everything that is said and done. But it does mean if something doesn't go your way, you take your ball and go home and you bail out. I can assure you, Jesus did not come to planet Earth and do what he did to start 245 different denominations. Let me ask you a question. Are you connected at Valley Mills Church? Now, I didn't ask you if you came to church here. I was asking you if you were connected. There's a big difference between participating and being committed. Who in here had breakfast before they came in this morning? Now, if you had eggs and bacon or eggs and ham or eggs or sausage, the chicken participated in your breakfast this morning. The pig was committed to your breakfast this morning. Now, here are a few reasons why people won't connect at church. Number one, connection means you can't hide from people. They know if you show up or not. I have heard a lot of people say that I like to go to big churches because people don't know if they come or not. You go to we grew up in a little tiny church, and if you weren't there, everybody in the church knew you weren't there. Another reason people say they don't like to get connected is because connection can be intimidating. Maybe you feel like you don't have it all together like the others do. I'm going to be talking about that later. And number three, a lot of people don't like to get connected because connection means vulnerability. It takes a lot of courage to be the real you in person. Now, these are all valid reasons to remain disconnected or just look for connection outside of the church. But deep down, I think we all have a desire for a real form of connection. We want someone to know us and accept us as we are. Let's now look at the awesome benefits and why we should be connected to the church. First of all, as great as private worship is, there is something about corporate worship where we all come together as one body and one family that private worship can never replace. One thing that's important to get connected at church is you learn about God when you connect with others. Have you ever been in a small group or a Bible study and shared life stories doing that? That strengthens our faith. God has designed to spur each other on in our faith. Turn, if you would, for me to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews 10, verses 24 and 25. Chapter 10, 24 and 25. Do you have it? Okay. And now let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day coming. Number two thing that's important about connecting to the church, you learn more about yourself when you connect with others. When you open yourself up to others, you allow your light to shine into some dark places. Sometimes we need encouragement, advice, wisdom, and direction, or just a place to confess to one another. God knew finding connection with other Christians would be the avenue for those things. And number three, I think we realize that you are not alone when you connect with others. I think two of the most important words in the English language are "me too." When someone comes to you and they're struggling with things, and some of the best things they can ever hear is, me too. May not be your struggle, but nothing wrong with letting them know that you struggle too. When people know that, they aren't the only one going through something. They don't feel as isolated. You ever feel like you're the only one in the world that's going through something? Well, I can assure you that is never the case. Let's look at 2 Corinthians for just a second, chapter 1, verse 3 and 4. That says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in our trouble. Why does he do that? So that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received. Now, just as important as it is for people to be connected to the church, it is just as, if not more important, for the church to be connected to people. Not just inside the church, but also to the community outside of the church. I think for the church to be authentically connected, it means it needs to do a better job of being transparent. I think the church as a whole, now when I mention the church, I'm not talking about this one singular body here at Valley Mills, I'm talking about the church as a whole body across the country, has done a pretty bad job of doing that. See, I'm afraid the world knows a whole lot more what the church is against than what it's for. I think most people are afraid to really get connected with the church because they feel like they will be judged and condemned because they feel like they don't measure up with the rest of the people in the church. Fear, guilt, and shame don't normally go too well over in the church. I hope as a church here at Valley Mills, we don't ever think for one second that the good people are sitting in here this morning and the bad people are out there. You see, the gospel is just not for the people outside of the church. The gospel is for the people inside of the church. Our Wednesday night Bible study, I read this little devotional. Find it here. It says, Jesus is not the ABC of the gospel. He is the A through Z. He is the Alpha and Omega, beginning, the end, the author, and the finisher. We don't start with Jesus and move on to better and deeper things of God. Growing in your Christian faith is not getting so strong and good that you need Jesus less and less, but it is an understanding how much you need him more and more. Bob mentioned last week, how could the Apostle Paul say that Jesus came to save sinners, which he was the worst? Bob was so right when he said that the closer you get to God and his word, that the more you will realize just how far short we all fall. We must never forget that the cross of Christ levels the playing field. See, we can be transparent with each other because we are all broken people. Max Lucado wrote, I think, a phenomenal thing that I think nails this on the head. And this is what he said. Judging others is the quick and easy way to feel good about ourselves. A convenient store ego boost. Standing next to the Hitlers and Jeffrey Dahmers of the world, and we boast, look, God, compared to them, I'm not that bad. But that's the problem. God doesn't compare us to them. They aren't the standard. Jesus is. And the Apostle Paul will argue, compared to him, nobody does anything that is good. Suppose for a minute God simplified matters and reduced the Bible down to one command. One must jump so high in the air that you touch the moon. No need to love your neighbor or pray or follow Jesus. Just touch the moon by a virtue of a jump and you will be saved. We would never make it. Now, there would be a few who jump 3 or 4 feet, even few who jump 5 or 6 feet. But compared to the distance we have to go, no one gets very far. They may jump 6 inches higher than someone else, but that doesn't give them any reason to boast. Now, he hasn't called us to touch the moon, but he may as well have. He said, you must be perfect as Jesus was. None of us can meet God's standard. As a result, none of us deserve to don the robe and stand behind the bench and judge others. Why? We aren't good enough. Jeffrey Dahmer made Jake jump 6 inches, and you may jump 6 feet. But compared to the 230,000 miles that remain, who can boast? The thought of it is almost comical. We who jump 3 feet looks at the fellow who jumped 3 inches and say, what a lousy jump. Why do we engage in such accusations? It's a ploy. As long as I'm thinking about your weakness, I don't have to think about mine. As long as I'm looking at your puny jump, I don't have to be honest about my own. See, you don't protect God's reputation by faking that you are okay when you aren't. Grace makes honest living possible. If you think God's primary goal for you is that you be an example of moral goodness rather than a trophy of His grace, you'll never be honest about your deepest sin, struggle, and secrets. You will always feel the pressure to pretend you are better than you really are. I pray that you never forget that your worst days are never so bad that you are beyond the reach of God's grace. And I also pray that your good days are never so good that you're beyond the need of God's grace. Let me ask you a question. How is a person made righteous or made right with God? And is this righteousness earned, or is it a gift? Now, most of us in here would say it's a gift, but we live like we have to earn it. If I could switch this one thought in your mind, it would change everything in your life. The way you feel about God, the way you feel about yourself, and the way you feel and treat others. It is 100% a gift and 0% earned. We must never forget that everything the law of God demands from us, the grace of God supplies for us as a gift. Let's look, if we can, in Romans chapter 4. I'll start at verse 3. Romans chapter 4, verse 3. It says, what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Verse 6, David says the same thing when he speaks of the blessedness of the man to whom God credits righteousness apart from works. Verse 23 and 24, the words that was credited to him were written not for him alone, not just Abraham. But the good news is, it says, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness, for us who believe in Him who raised Jesus from the dead. And then 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 says, God made Him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. Now, I want to look at a story real quick. That's been told many, many times, been called one of the greatest short stories ever told. You guys have read it a lot of times, ton of messages on it, Sunday school lessons taught on it, Bible studies on it. But I heard something about a month ago on a message on it that I've never saw in my life before by reading this story over and over and over. And it's in Luke chapter 15. It's the prodigal son. Everybody in here probably knows the story. We know it's a son that goes to his father and asks for his inheritance so he can leave the father's house. So he goes out and lives unrighteously living till he gets stone broke, ends up working for a farmer and feeding pigs, and gets so hungry that the pig food looks good. And then he just comes to himself and decides my father's house wasn't a bad place after all, and he decides to go back home. And he creates this story he's going to tell his father to hopefully be accepted back. And I want you for a minute to look at verse 19. He says something that's absolutely incredible. Part of the speech was, I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. Do you realize what he's saying when he says this? That is performance-based religion at its finest. What he is implying by saying this is that at one time he was worthy. If he didn't say he wasn't worthy, there would be a time he obviously thought that he was worthy. When was that? Well, he probably thought he was worthy as long as he was at home doing his father's business. But now that he left home and was doing and was disobedient, he is now not worthy. Can I give you some good news that you might think is bad news, but it's really, really good news? There's never been a day in your life when you've been worthy to be called a son of God. You being a child of God has nothing to do with your performance for God, but everything to do with God's performance for you through Christ and his finished work on the cross. You see, we all have a problem feeling like the prodigal. We come to church sometimes and we don't feel worthy to praise God because of what we did last week. So we can't sing praises, we can't raise our hands. But if I read my devotions every day this week, I can come and sing and I can sing praises and raise my hand to the Lord and worship him because now I am worthy. Charles Spurgeon said, if salvation was on worthiness, there would be none saved. You see, I can't say I'm worthy this week, but I wasn't worthy last week. We have three little granddaughters, and two of them old enough to now talk and carry on conversations and know what you're saying and everything. And ever since they've been old enough to do this, I play this little game with them. I'll talk to them and say, how much does Papa love you? And they'll say, so much. How long will Papa love you? Forever. What could you do to ever get Papa not to love you? Nothing. If you ever get in trouble or need anything, who are you going to come to? Papa, you? And then they always give me a big old hug. And I think they like doing it because if times go by and I don't bring it up, every now and then they'll say, Papa, ask me the questions. You see, I want them to know, and I hope they never forget, that my love for them has nothing to do with what they do or don't do, what they have or don't have, what they accomplish or don't accomplish. Yes, we serve the Lord. And yes, we serve each other, but we serve as sons and daughters, not slaves or servants. We serve God out of what we already have and not to get. I find it amazing in Paul's letters to the church that any time before he talks about the gospel obligation, and yes, there's an obligation to the gospel, but before he ever brings those obligations up, he marinates and marinates and marinates us in gospel declaration. He always reminds and tells us who we are in Christ before he tells us to go out now and live like it. And by knowing who you are, it makes it easier to live out who you are. Apostle Paul says, love as you have been loved. Accept as you have been accepted. Forgive as you have been forgiven. Take what the Lord has done for you and share it away. Share it with other people and give it away. So what is our calling? What are we to do then as a church to be authentically connected? Number one, I believe, is to follow the pattern of Jesus and the early church. Look, if you would, to Acts for me, chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. Acts chapter 2, verse 42 and 47. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those that were being saved. Can you imagine being the church where everybody's needs are met? You know, we are the hands and feet of Jesus. If that's the case, we need to make sure our hands are reaching and our feet are moving. Number two, be deeply connected with people from all walks of life. If the only people you know and associate with are people that act like you, talk like you, are like you, believe like you, well, you're not authentically connected to people. So make sure that you are connected with people from all walks of life. Number three, our calling is to establish close friends who we mentor and inspire. Number four, to establish close friends who mentor and inspire us. We had dinner with Clyde and Marilyn on Friday night, and Clyde has inspired me so much, it's unbelievable. Number five, to be so deeply connected to one another that we know each other's needs and serve when possible. What an example that would be for the world to see how the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is supposed to be. When we do these things, I think the prayer that Jesus prayed in the garden for us is being answered. Our world today is in so much need of hope. I read where suicide is the number two killer among young people in the United States. The reason I think that is true is because they don't see any hope around them. We must let them know that there is hope, but it's not found in a political party or a job or possessions they may acquire or achievements they may receive, but the hope they are so desperately looking for is in a person, and that person is the Lord Jesus Christ. If you are here this morning or listening over the internet and you have never trusted Christ as your Savior and put your faith and trust in His finished work at the cross for you, then I pray today you will make the most important decision you have ever made. God loves you so much that He sent His one and only Son to do for you what you could never do for yourself, and that is to save you from your sins so you could spend eternity with Him in heaven. I'm going to play a song, and I'm not going to play, but they're going to play a song on the video that sums up our entire sermon series on our mission as a church to love God and to love people. And then the worship team will come up and sing an invitation song. And if you'd like to come up today and be saved and know that every sin you've ever committed has been totally forgiven, I would pray that you would come up today and make the most important decision you could ever make. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you much for this day, Lord, and thank you for all your blessings. And Lord, thank you for your word, the faithfulness, truthfulness of it, Father. Lord, I thank you that you use broken people like us to go into a world and share with broken, other broken people that there's hope. Help us share the love and the mercy and grace, Lord, that you have for them, for the world so desperately needs to hear it. If there's anybody this morning that has not accepted your Son as their Lord and Savior, I pray, Lord, that this morning will be the morning that they make the most important decision they've ever made. I ask all these things in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.
I've been running in circles, jumping the hurdles, getting caught in that rush of doing so much. I'm feeling kind of worn out, all this checking the boxes, trying to be flawless, has me spinning my head, catching my breath, too afraid to slow down. I tell myself to keep this up, that God wants more than just my love. But I've been complicating things, it's just like me to overthink. Gotta keep it real simple, keep it real simple. Can be loud, 'cause love is what it's all about. I tell myself to keep this up, that all God wants is just my love. No more complicated things, no more need to overthink. Gotta keep it real simple, keep it real simple. God, you love people. rescues hearts and changes lives. Love is all we need to make things right. Gotta keep it real simple.
First, I want to say thanks, Tom. It was an amazing message. I hope you all agree on that. But these Sundays, we put these songs and these sermons and stuff together. It's not something that we do because we want to look amazing. And I know I can speak for Tom's heart in this too. We don't do this for like our own edification or our own glory or anything. We're trying to present something to you. We're trying to present something for you to think about in your life. You know, we come and we go, and we make choices every single day. But there are clearly important choices, way more important choices than the ones that we make. And it's not always easy to do the things that are uncomfortable. So Tom brought up a lot of really awesome points. I hope you take that with you and really think about it. If there's something in your life that you need to change, I pray that you would decide to do that. This is a time that we do an invitation to what we would describe as the altar. Coming up here, there's going to be people here that can meet and pray with you if that's what you want to do. If you want to make that decision, you just want to talk to somebody. Maybe you're struggling with somebody or something this morning. But we're going to sing this song, and I spoke earlier about routine, how we do these things all the time. And our mind kind of discounts them sometimes. We come in here and we go, okay, now's the invitation time, and then there's going to be, you know, offering and communion. But slow down. Don't discount it. Just think if you need this opportunity.
Loves like a hurricane.
Good morning. We'll be following the same order of service that we have been for the last few weeks. I'll start with the offering prayer, followed by the communion devotion, and after the prayer, you'll be dismissed to visit one of the communion stations, and the offering buckets are in the back of the auditorium. So, will you bow for a word of prayer, please? Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for all that you do for us. We thank you, Lord, for all that you bless us with, and we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to give back to you a portion of what is rightfully yours. We just pray, Lord, that you will bless the offering as it will be used to maintain and operate your great church, Valley Mills, and the various ministries in the church and out into the community and beyond. We just ask that you'll bless the gift as well as the giver. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Currently, in our 12-step group, we are working on the step where we make a list of the wrongs that we have committed during our active addiction. Now, this is not a list that we share, but a list rather that we keep to reflect on. Now, those are just wrongs that we can remember committing. I think that if we took the number of sins that we actually committed and multiplied that thousands of times with that list, you may have a close number to the amount of sin that was committed in a lifetime. And I also think if you took the sins of the people who had lived before us, the people living now, and people who yet to come, multiply all of those sins together, that would give you an idea of the weight of the sin that Jesus came here to earth to die for. The Bible tells us that God loves us, even as undeserving as we are, so much that he sent Jesus here to earth to give his life as the ultimate sacrifice for sin. That's a love that's incomprehensible to me, but I'm certainly grateful for it. 1 John 4:9-13 tells us, "This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as the atoning sacrifice for our sins." Dear friends, God loved us so much that we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us of his Spirit. If we love God, then we will love people. And if we are serving God, part of serving God is sharing his message of love and truth and salvation. Salvation made possible by Jesus when he willingly gave his life on the cross for us. As we come now to a time of communion at this table, we remember that the cup represents Jesus' blood that was shed. The bread represents his body that was broken and crucified on the cross. Will you bow for a word of prayer, please? Heavenly Father, God, we thank you. Lord, we don't deserve anything that you do for us, but we just thank you for the love and the grace and the mercy that you show us. And we thank you, Lord, so much for your Son, Jesus, who was willing to pay the price for our sin. We just ask now that you'll bless this time, Lord, as we remember that sacrifice. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.